Very much, and thank you for inviting us. Elizabeth, it's just grand to see politics and democracy on the go, whatever your views are. And can I say, first of all, nothing I say in the debates with David will be personal, and I know it won't be personal the other way. We go back a long way. I've a lot of time for him. He's a jolly good politician. So politics are a bit iffy, but that's about it. But we've always got on, so let's just make that plain. I know it's reciprocated. Now, through my door the other day came two leaflets. This one, Scotland's Future, from the Yes campaign, headed Scotland Can. And another leaflet came through my door, which was from Better Together, which was Scotland Really Can't. And what I want to put to this is the debate about, can we look after ourselves? Can we afford to do it? And if we can, why should we do it? Now, first of all, I plead in aid of my argument that we can afford to do it the following. It starts off this quote saying, the union is under serious threat. The question we have to answer is, what should we do? The wrong response, often reflected in the rhetoric of Gordon Brown, is to try to cow or bully Scotland into remaining part of the UK through fear of the economic consequences of going it alone. This will not work. First, supporters of independence will always be able to cite examples of small, independent and thriving economies across Europe, such as Finland, Switzerland and Norway. It would be wrong to suggest that Scotland could not be another such successful, independent country. That was David Cameron in 2007. Nothing has changed. The argument about whether or not we can support ourselves and look after ourselves is crystal clear. I don't want to go through all the heavy duty stuff again, but if you read the Better the Yes campaign's leaflet, you will see the resources that Scotland has, even if we parked the oil and the gas. And just in passing, I'm really quite taken aback to find that oil and gas are a huge problem. It's like saying to somebody you won the lottery, but it's a problem for you to have all that money because you'll not have it forever. Of course you don't have it forever. We've got it for 50 years and you can invest it in other things as Norway did, setting up its oil fund, which by the way now has more coming in interest than it does in revenues from the sea. So the question isn't, can we afford to do it, which is what I think we're going to be hearing. We can. David Cameron thought so, and I believe in what David Cameron has to say, and I'm sure David Mundell does as well. So the question also is, why should we do it? Well, I'm quite simple about things. I look at what is a nation. And sometimes there are simple tests for a nation. A nation can apply to be a member of the UN. We can't. A nation in Europe can decide to be in or out of Europe. Cameron probably wants to take us out. We can't decide in Scotland. A nation can decide whether or not it goes to war and sends its young men and women to die, usually in wars that are a waste of time and usually in wars that make matters worse. I cite Iraq and Afghanistan. A nation decides whether or not it wants to have nuclear weapons. A nation decides how it will tax its people and how it will use those taxes. A nation decides who will get benefits, how it will pay pensions. Now, Scotland does none of those things. Now, I know that people in the Better Together camp say we're a nation. You see, it fails that test for me. And I look at my card here, which I've carried for 15 years in the Parliament, and I think of all the things we managed to do on justice, on education, on housing, on the environment, and so on. But we only do it by leave of Westminster. Because Westminster pays the money over. And Westminster can cut off the money, as it did recently. 30% cut in our capital budget. Cut in our revenue budget. So we're not in control of our major resources. That, to me, is a test of a nation. So we can do it. David Cameron says so. Are we a nation? I leave you to think about that question as I put it to you. And why should we do it? Well, I want us, first of all, to get the governments we vote for. In the last 60 years, Scotland hasn't changed what's happened at Westminster except twice. And most of my life, we haven't got the governments that Scotland voted for. Like it or not, I'm not talking about the SNP getting in. I'm talking about after a referendum, after independence, 2016, Scotland gets the government that votes for Labour, Conservative, Green, combinations thereof, SNP, Socialist. Nevertheless, it gets what it votes for and lives with it. So that's important. Democracy is important. We'll be able to say things at the UN. We'll be able to do things about war and so on. But what we will also be able to do is to be a socially just society, which we are not just now. We have food banks. We have food banks across the Scottish borders. Whoever thought in peacetime, in an oil and gas rich nation or across the UK, we would have food banks. We have the bedroom tax, penalising people with an extra bedroom. Not because they want an extra bed, it just happens to be there, but they're asked somehow, they're being asked to move. Where to? If you live in Peebles or West Lynn, where are you going to move to? So that was unjust. What I look forward to in an independent Scotland, making those big decisions which I may not agree with, but I'll live with them, is democracy, a nation that can really call itself a nation because it has all the powers, the foibles of every other nation that calls itself that, and social justice for our young, for our poor, for the disadvantaged, and for our pensioners. And most on top of all that, to protect our public services, such as the NHS, to keep it absolutely free at the point of need and accountable to the democratically elected boards and the people. Look down south, see what's happening. So my argument is positive. It is questions for you, and I look forward to having your questions later. Thank you very much. Thank you.